I'm James. This is Fred. We've got coffee. We got, you know, we got our room to do a little talking here.
It's Monday morning.
It's Monday morning. We're gonna do a little talking here as we get you set for another set of games this week. We've already got the 2-minute drills that we talked about. So,
but there's so many more games, so much going on, James, that you can't just limit it sometimes to quick 2-minute drills.
Before we get to a game,
yeah,
I gotta ask you this: if the season ended today,
right,
in the East San Gabriel Valley,
East San Gabriel Valley,
yes, who's player of the year?
Oh man,
I was just thinking about this.
That's a tough one. I think if it ended today,
yeah,
I would go with Stephen Comstock over at Northview.
Now, who are your contenders?
If it ended today, I think over at Los Sotos, Cody Almost has had a pretty good year. I think you've got to look at Warren Bryan over at Damien with what they're doing right now.
Mm-hmm.
If you know Glendora gets running. Gets going, and it looks like they might, you know, Wooldridge.
They got a big game Thursday night.
Into the equation. I think there's, you know, you could talk about these things mid-season, but they all settle themselves out as we get deeper down in the playoffs. It's like that every year. But I think if, you know, you look at Comstock last week, the 5-touchdown performance. Charter Oak, which is obviously number one team in the area, James, there's almost some defensive guys you can look at over there. And I'd have to look at that a little bit closer. But, you know, they're going to have some guys that would obviously have to be in that conversation. They took care of Northview pretty good in that first game of the year. But they don't have that one guy who's putting up those MVP numbers. And sometimes it does come down to numbers. And they're doing a great job as a team beating a lot of people. So That's a tough one.
That's true. Yeah, I was just thinking about that on the way.
Those are some of the names, the guys I would throw out just off the top of my head.
And I just want to give a major props here to Richard Salazar over at Nogales. He's doing it again, Fred. He's working the magic. I know it's okay. We understand it's the, you know, it's the kind of like the second level in our area. But he's doing an unbelievable job.
Yeah, and you know, they have this moniker. They call themselves the greatest high school in America. The great thing is, their kids and the people really believe that.
Sure.
They've done a social media campaign. I've talked about this before. I've written about it. Last year, they had the great preseason, Jane, and I think they went into league thinking, you know, we've got to just get through this, let's get to the playoffs, because they were ranked in Division 13, I think, number one or two for that year. And they lost that one game in the beginning. They lost the game at the end. And they knocked them out of the playoffs entirely when they were a top 10 team. And I think they learned a lot from that.
That's great.
And I think what they've learned from last year is these Mountview League games are everything. This is going to decide, you know, because there's so many teams in Division 13, finishing third in the league isn't good enough.
No.
They found that out last year. You've got to finish first or second. In some cases, even first
to get in,
depending on how it goes out. So they're not taking anything for granted. I think they are now in league taking these things one game at a time and taking them seriously.
If the last don't give any indication, boy. Woo.
Yeah, and this could be a dangerous game this week because they're playing Workman, who's showed some signs that they're turning the corner in themselves. I don't know where Workman's at you know, Nogales level yet, but they remind me of a Nogales last year in that they're putting in the work. You're starting to see results. Is it going to be enough to get Nogales this week? I don't think so. I like the way Nogales is playing. But you're right. They've built a culture over there that they believe in. And they're really looking at these next 4 weeks. I know. They want to make noise in the playoffs. But they know before they get there, they've got to take care of business. And I like them to win the Mountview League as we go.
I think it's just a great job. And speaking of great jobs, you folks, you just cannot overstate the coaching job that Steve Haggerty and the rest of the guys have done at Bishop Amat. You talk about a team that did not listen to the noise, they did not listen to anybody after the preseason. They got down to work, and it's paying off now because they're going to be 3-0 by the end of Friday night.
You're already guaranteeing that one over Crespi. It looks like it, you know. And good for Bishop Amat because, you know, like we said, when they were 0-4, things were looking bad, and you have a whole bye week to think about it, which sometimes makes it even tougher. When you're 0-4, what you want to do is get right back on the field.
Yep.
They had 2 weeks to think about it. And they followed up that win over Loyola on the road, which is huge, coming back here and winning at home against a Notre Dame team who, you know, on paper is a pretty formidable team.
That was talking to Evan Barnes.
That was not going to be an easy game. And Notre Dame knew who their quarterback was at this point. They had a week of film. And Bishop Amat scored enough points there. Their offense looked impressive. Their defense is still doing what it has to be. I think they get crispy this week and then go to 3-0 in league. And then it's going to be the big game the following week.
And they play Sarah?
Sarah before the Alamany game.
Right.
And that's
and it, and I mentioned this in the column.
Yeah.
It's not impossible, folks, to see Amat beat Sarah. It's just, if you think you're going to put an L behind that game for Amat, you're wrong.
No.
These guys are now, the one thing I will say, and we don't want to belabor this point, because there's a few games we want to talk about, but it just looked like during that bye week that they had a plan.
Yeah.
They knew, okay, we're not going to have Blake Larchuleta. We're going to put in this wide receiver, put him at quarterback. They put a plan for him to succeed, and it worked.
Yeah, yeah. And it's worked against these teams, James. You look down the line. The tough part about Bishop Amat, and I'll just say this again, yeah, to be honest with you, is they, put it in NBA basketball terms.
Yeah.
But they're a team that's gonna may go into the last week with a shot against Chaminade. Mm-hmm. They may win that game. But once they get to the playoffs, they remind me of this 8-seed in the Western Conference that is, we're gonna get in, we're gonna play one of these heavyweights, we're gonna lose, we're gonna go back and do it again next year. Yeah. Where do they go? I mean, are they going to be comfortable hovering around that spot for years to come?
Yeah.
Because by winning these games, they're not going to fall out of Division One. But it doesn't look like they're taking steps forward to beat those top teams in Division One. So, this is great. This is great because they're not going to bottom out.
No.
But they are that, like I said, they're that 7th, 8th team in the Western Conference. And in the NBA, they obviously, that's not where you want to be.
No,
you
want
to bottom up to rebuild. And in high school terms, that means dropping down division.
Yeah.
Or you've got to get those transfers and get those recruits that you can compete with the best teams in D1s, the a la the St. John Boscos and Modern Days. So it feels good. I know they're 2-4. They won those two games. But you've got to ask yourself long term, if you're Bishop Amat, who are we and where are we headed? Right now, it looks like you look at, the Mission League. It's nowhere near the Trinity.
And what it's going to change next year, because Crespi's out, so there's going to be one less team in that league next year. So, and they earn.
You see it sorting itself out. Before this divisional realignments, all those teams competed in Division One. Now you're seeing more and more teams in the Mission fall out of that. I mean, how many teams are going to be in Division One next year from Mission League? Three? I mean, you're seeing that league start to
bought himself out a little bit.
Right. I mean, there was a time, I'd say, maybe 3 or 4 years ago, where you were trying to make arguments, are they as good as the Trinity, or are our top three teams as good as top three teams?
I'll say it.
And you can make that argument.
Can't see that now.
That whole league is falling down. And some of them may have chances to win championships in lower divisions and make themselves appear that things are great. But it's you have to watch that. It's where that league and where Amat is.
I think it's, Chaminade played Bosco tough a couple weeks ago. I think if they play another Trinity League team, they would make it a tough game. I just don't know.
Yeah, Chaminade reminds me of the Amat team a few years ago that went to the semifinals and should have beaten Corona Centennial in that semifinal game and got the championship. They should have. They had that team. I feel like Chaminade has that team this year. That's the one everyone's chasing.
I just want to mention one last thing. We're going to talk about a couple of games here. I just want to mention one last thing. We hate to keep harboring this, but South Hills just won again.
Yeah, South Hills, they went on the road and beat Ayala. And, I think it's going to be South Hills, Glendora at the end of the day.
And how fun
fighting this out for the Palomares League title. And it's great. They're defensively, they're doing enough job. If you listen to them after the game, South Hills, they felt like it was a game. And Tommy Kiss said the same thing. It could have been worse than it was. They actually kind of let them, let them in that game, let it be closer than it should. South Hills, they are. I mean, if you're asking about, you asked about player of the year, if you're doing coach of the year up to this point, if I did it midway through, I think you would have to go.
Gotta go with Matt.
You gotta go with Matt Bechtel right now. I mean, it's fun. Him and Jim Bonds, I think, are neck and neck. What they're doing on that side of town.
And they both have that presence. And the common thing is that they both have a presence with each other on the sideline. I went to the St. Francis game for the first time on Friday night. And I understand what you said, that Jim has that presence about that whole staff has been there forever, and they have a presence. And you get that same feeling at South Hills. Bechtel, those kids hang on every word he says. Right. And that staff they have, I worked with Albert Rodriguez, who was the previous head coach there. He's they're changing things around. You know where that Glendora and South Hills game is going to be at, by the way?
Where?
It's District Field. Man, what a year to have them.
And Coach of the Year, guys, who else is in that conversation? I mean, there's other ones. I think Jim Singheiser, who won it last year, puts himself right back in. You know, after winning the championship, it's so hard to keep doing that. He has those signature wins that went over Sure, the big one over South Almonte last week. Yeah. And South Almonte, let's look at that game. They played them as tough as anyone this year. They're going to be, and I think Singheiser pointed this out on social media, telling people, watch them in Division 12.
It's on my phone.
Watch them. South Almonte, sure. Could that be a Division 12 special down the line?
Jim sent me a message. Yeah. We're in Division 12. Be ready to get South Almonte.
Some other games, James, that we'll talk about Friday?
Yeah, Charter Oak and Los Altos.
Charter Oak and Los Altos. I think, Charter Oak's going to win this game. I think Los Altos is good. Mm-hmm. I think when you look at their schedule, they had that win over San Marino, which continues to look good now that San Marino went, but they also had the loss to Glendora. I just don't think that they're good enough. I think they're going to wind up finishing probably. I like Diamond Ranch to beat them down the line when those teams eventually meet. But
what a great game!
Yeah, it's going to be a great game. But I like Charter Oak, and I think this is a game. It won't be. Obviously last week against Diamond Ranch, that was a close game. I think Charter Oak wins this game by 3 touchdowns.
Right? I just want to mention Eric Martinez could possibly.
He's another one.
You could put in. When you do the 1-2-3 trifecta, he's got to be what he's done at Diamond Ranch has been absolutely.
Absolutely.
So we're missing our friend Aaron Talesian. We miss him a lot. And one of the reasons why we miss him is because of games like this. South Pasadena is playing his alma mater, Temple City.
Yeah.
But this has ramifications all over the place.
Yeah, these are playoff spots. And the reason is, in the Rio Hondo League, James, a lot of those teams are in Division 11, 12, and 13. And to qualify, you've got to finish first or second. So South Pass is coming off the loss to Monrovia. I said at the beginning, I don't care that they're winless. I think Monrovia is going to wind up winning it all, and San Marino probably second. So these teams like South Pass, Temple City, they can't afford to lose these games to each other, because one of them may have to beat San Marino to finish second down the line, if it comes down to that, or maybe even Monrovia, depending on how that game shakes out. So this is big. They both are having really good years. You got Temple, Temple City has really been impressive. Impressive when you consider how bad they were last year.
Riley's acting is
terrible.
Doing a great job.
And, that's an interesting one. I like Temple City to win that game, believe it or not.
Really?
I'm taking the Rams.
Well, one of the things you have to concern yourself if you're a South Pasadena fan, the last two games they've been outscored 84-27.
Yeah. And then they beat Alvarado. I think the wheels have sort of fallen off them. I think there's going to be some confidence issues. While Temple City is riding sky high and wants these games so bad.
And the action just doesn't start on Friday. It starts on Thursday. Now, we understand that Glendora is probably going to beat Diamond Bar. That's going to be an interesting game. But the other one, and who would have ever thought that Pioneer and Lucerna would be a game to watch? Pioneer is 1-0, and Lucerna is 0-1. If Lucerna is not careful, Fred, they could be 0-2 by the end of the season.
Yeah, well, I think Lucerna now, they're in a division where they still might get into the playoffs because there's so few teams in that division, but they've got to start winning some games.
Yeah.
I mean, to lose a Del Rio League game like that, they've owned Santa Fe for a while now. And
what an alarming loss.
Yeah. I don't, I'm still not picking them to lose. I just don't see how that's going to happen.
It's going to be a close game. How
far, and let's just speak about Lucerna La Mirada. I mean, how far those teams in one year taking a step back?
It's tough to say because, Lucerna's, La Mirada's played such a tough preseason schedule.
Yeah, they lost their first game of the year, that league game.
They lost to Mayfair, that game usually just tells who's going to be first or second in the Suburban League. And, La Mirada did.
Some of the laws are falling apart. I mean, there's one law left, and that's La Habra. And they did good beating Sunny Hills. And that was an undefeated team that they put a thumping on. And we all kind of saw that coming.
Well, the three zones right now, what's the one team that you're really zoned in on? Okay, that could be a sleeper team for the playoffs.
Ooh, wow. Sleeper team for the playoffs.
Yeah.
It all comes down to divisions, James. I think you have to look at it down the line. Yeah, I like, Covina. Oof, this is tough. I really, it's hard. Right now, sleeper team, it's going to be, it's tough to call. I like that Division 12.
Is fun.
Is going to be an interesting one for me to see. Is it, who's going to get in? Is it going to be Sure? Is it going to be Covina? you know, Division 11.
Arcadia? Arcadia's at 11? With
Division 11 and Arcadia, and Arcadia's got to make sure it gets in. You know, they had a tough loss last week.
Yes.
But I thought Arcadia, those first three games, were going to be the toughest three games in the league, and I thought if they came out of that 2-1, which
fine.
They have, they were going to be fine.
Yeah.
So I don't think Apache fans, I think, you know, cause for great concern. As we get up higher in the divisions, you know, can Charter and St. Francis make a run? I might say St. Francis in Division 3,
yeah.
Even though it's Division 3.
Right.
A game that we haven't talked about yet,
yes.
And is probably as big as any game for them in the Valley,
mm-hmm.
Is Damien at Upland. Damien had the big win over Chino Hills, Upland over Rancho Cucamonga.
And
this is interesting because, you know, Upland, you know, beating Rancho, and Rancho beat Bishop Lamont. You know, how, you know, we're going to really find out where Damien is in a game like this.
I agree.
Juggernauts like this.
I agree.
Damien is in Division 4,
mm-hmm.
Right?
No, 3.
They're in Division 3.
No, they're in 4. You're right.
Division 4.
They're in 4.
In Division 4.
Right.
You hang with a team like Upland. You give them a scare. This game is going to be on the road. That really sets the table for you down the line, believe in yourself. This is going to be by far their toughest game of the year. I say by far, knowing that they played
Rancho.
Charter Oak. And lost.
Yeah.
This is going to be the toughest game by far for Damien. Yeah. I don't think they're going to win it, but can they make this a competitive game? That's what I want to see on Friday night.
It's an interesting storyline, so to speak. And they'll make the playoffs. There's no. They'll get in as an athlete.
Well, they've got to make sure they finish third. And the key was beating Chino Hills this past week, and they did that.
Yeah.
So I
don't. But even
if they lose up in a Rancho.
But even as an at large, team, I think
they should. When you count strength of schedule, considering
yeah,
that two of those. Considering, let's say the three losses. Let's say they go 7-3.
Yeah.
Their three losses are Charter Oak, Upland, and Rancho Cucamonga.
That's pretty impressive.
Who's keeping them out?
I agree with you. You know, it's a big storyline as well. So as we're getting down the line, the storylines get bigger, deeper.
Yeah.
So that only means one thing: you're following myself, or you're following Fred. We got a bunch of guys covering games this week on our social media platforms, on Twitter and Facebook, and on our website. You know, Friday night, Fred does a great job of getting you the Friday night recap of all the games that we covered. And then as you're sleeping, I'm working. I'm putting the Saturday morning quarterback together so that when you wake up in the morning, you've got it there. And I'll just mention again, Santa Fe, St. Francis, they're pretty darn
good. Yeah, I know it.
You know what I love,
James, as a final thought,
yeah.
Is that, you know, a lot of these divisions are really shaped. There are some real possibilities for our local teams that are in the right divisions for them to make deep runs. And you know,
congratulations to Glenn Martinez. I have this right now.
You know, there are a lot of teams in other areas who are saying the same thing.
Yeah.
I think it's great. And again, I was someone who was against this when it started,
mm-hmm.
And I've started to develop kind of a love for it.
Sure.
I kind of like how these divisions are shaping up.
Yep.
In CIF. You know, I will give all those guys at CIF, I think they did a great job. I know it still sometimes doesn't make sense that teams from the same league go in different playoff divisions, but I'll tell you what, once you get to the playoffs, this is nice.
It is.
This is shaping up. It is pretty nice.
And I hope the fans realize that Rob Wygott is our commissioner, mm-hmm. for the section. He's just not an administrator. He's a football fan.
Yeah.
And so, and we've had this discussion with him, I've had this discussion with him many, many times. He wants to see competitive games.
Yeah.
What does that mean? Well, they have this social media thing this year, packing the house. You want to
right.
pack the house. This is how you pack the house when you have great games
yeah.
in the playoffs. And this is what he wants. And now his vision has now become a reality. Right?
Yeah. Yeah.
And we're all the recipient for it.
Yeah.
I think
it's really
it's just great.
Yeah, these divisions are great.
And one thing I should mention.
We've got 4 weeks to settle it out before we lay down the brackets.
Next week, we'll probably start our version of bracketology. I'll start taking a look at the divisions, seeing who can be in, who could be out. Things of that sort, so that we get to that countdown to Selection Sunday, you'll know what's going on. But again, just make sure you follow us on Friday night, everybody. We hope to see you at the game. By the way, I just want to mention one quick and final thing. I had so many great responses from everybody at the St. Francis game. I don't know if it's been where you've been going to, Fred, but we want to thank everybody for the kind words. We do this because of you guys. We're just as much as football fans as you are. We enjoy talking ball, so please, when you see us at a game, just make sure don't be afraid to come over and say hello to us. We love talking ball with you guys. And,
yeah.
We just can't wait.
Enjoy the free hot dogs, too.
Oh. Well, I didn't have anything free, but I will say this. St. Francis does a great job on their Friday night.
Oh, they got one of the best spreads. I remember that.
We'll see
St.
you guys.
St. Francis, I'm going to ask you one thing in the next couple of years.
Oh, here we go.
This super powerhouse.
Here we go.
Can you build a press box over there?
I don't think so.
Can you build a press box at the stadium? I know it's a beautiful stadium the way it's set up, but God, I'd like a place to overlook that thing and just set up a Friday night.
Folks,
they do it right. So,
folks, we'll see you all on Friday night. If not at the game, we'll see you hopefully on social media. Thank you very much.